Good evening, and welcome to the 28th Annual Minnesota Book Awards Ceremony. I'm Elaine Hopkins, Director of Programs and the Minnesota Book Awards for the Friends of the St. Paul Public Library, and I'd like to welcome you to this evening of celebration in honor of Minnesota's writers, a celebration that is a testament to the incredible literary community we have here. For the last 10 years, the Friends has been privileged to support readers and writers statewide, celebrating and moving beyond the book into the community. Thank you very much for being here tonight to attest to and celebrate the tremendous talent and passion for the literary life that we as Minnesotans have created. Everything we do with this program is with a great network of support and partners. I'd like to thank all the organizations who make tonight's event possible, fully listed out in our program, especially our lead sponsor, Brain Fuse, and Alaris Financial, sponsor of the preface reception you've just been enjoying. We are grateful to our generous foundation and grant supporters, the City of St. Paul's Cultural Star Program, the Huss Foundation, the Catherine B. Anderson Fund of the St. Paul Foundation, the McKnight Foundation, and the Poled Family Foundation. And thank you very, very much to our local independent bookseller, Red Balloon Bookshop, which has graciously donated 25% of tonight's proceeds to support the Book Awards. Now, it is my pleasure to introduce our host for the evening, someone who will sound very familiar to those of you who tune into the airwaves of Minnesota Public Radio, Stephanie Curtis. Stephanie is the senior producer of The Thread. She's produced events, daily news shows, documentaries, conferences, and call-ins for NPR News. She also was among the pioneering producers who launched 89.3 The Current. You can hear her discuss movies on the Cube Critic podcasts. So please join me in giving a warm welcome to Stephanie Curtis.
Thank you. I'm really thrilled to be here. I'm lucky enough to head up our book coverage at Minnesota Public Radio, which is one of the, I talk about movies on the air, but you don't hear me talk about books, but I'm the person that gets to put on talking volumes and put together the Thread podcast. And so this is just, I'm just absolutely thrilled to be here tonight, surrounded by book lovers and authors and booksellers and publishers. Before we start celebrating tonight's finalists, let's take a moment to honor a member of the Minnesota book community who's no longer with us. Gary Schultz is the former owner of Once Upon a Crime Bookstore, and with his wife, Pat Frovarp. He died last week recently after a long battle with leukemia. A knowledgeable, enthusiastic promoter of local mystery writers, he had a stellar regional and national reputation as a bookseller, and Gary will be dearly missed. Let's move on to tonight's honorees. There were 252 nominations for the 8 category awards we'll be presenting tonight, in addition to 3 special awards. Previous Minnesota Book Award winners are here to present the honors, which include, if you haven't seen them over there, they're gorgeous, a hand-blown glass award by St. Paul artist Dick Huss, and the Willie August Project is back. Their music has been written up in national jazz publications, and band leader Ben Seams has customized music for each winning title from both original works and adaptations. Feel free to chat with the trio after the awards to find out more about their recordings or performances. So let's begin at the very beginning, our first category of the night, the Award for Children's Literature, sponsored by Books for Africa, the world's largest shipper of donated text and library books to the African continent. Based in St. Paul, BFA has been working to end the book famine in Africa for more than 25 years. Let's give a warm round of applause to Books for Africa. The finalists in children's literature are comprised of previous book award winners and some debut contenders. Presenting the award is Phyllis Root, 1997 winner for Aunt Nancy and Old Man Trouble.
Thank you, Stephanie. I couldn't be more thrilled and happier to be here tonight with this award. In the field of writing and illustrating for children, here in Minnesota, we have something truly special, and I am honored to be a part of it. Each year, there are more and more exciting additions to an already impressive pool of books created by writers and artists dedicated to inspiring young people and setting them on the path to becoming lifelong readers. This year's four books are no exception. And I want to add, too, that in the wealth of children's writers that we have in Minnesota, just to be nominated for a Minnesota Book Award is a huge honor. The first time I was ever at one of these was maybe 1995 at St. Thomas in the auditorium. And Ellen Hart, who that year won for Mystery, I remember her saying, "This is a big deal." And it is a big deal. So, here are the finalists. Please hold your applause until they're all announced. Behold a Baby by Stephanie Watson, illustrated by Joy Ong, published by Bloomsbury Children Books. Dad's First Day by Mike Winooka, published by Bloomsbury Children's Books. Red, A Crayon Story by Michael Hall, published by Green Willow Books, HarperCollins Publishers, and 10 Pigs, An Epic Bath Adventure by Derek Anderson, published by Orchard Books Scholastic. The envelope, please. The award goes to Michael Hall, Red, A Crayon Story.
This is really heavy.
Red, A Crayon Story is my fifth book, and I've been asked many times why it took me so long to get around to dedicating a book to my wife. It's a question that's been asked me many times by the same person. So, Deborah, I want to say that I want to say I love you. This trophy belongs to you. I hope this gets me off the hook. And happy 31st anniversary. Thank you very much.
Next, we have the award for poetry, a category sponsored by Wellington Management, a real estate investment, development, and property management company which values involvement and investment in the community that goes well beyond real estate deals by using time and talents to become actively engaged with nonprofit organizations. Its employees truly make a difference. Please join me in thanking Wellington Management. Now here to present the Poetry Award is Richard Terrell. He's author of Coming Late to Rachmaninoff, a 2004 winner.
Thank you. Poetry is that writing we all aspire to on our best days and sometimes fall short. In fact, poetry may be the category in which the finalists in all the other genres secretly wish they'd been nominated. It's a big club, but membership is open to all. Fret not. This year's finalists in poetry are Beautiful Wall by Ray Gonzalez, published by Boa Editions. Borrowed Wave by Rachel Moritz, published by Corre Press. Home Studies by Julie Gard, published by New Rivers Press, and Modern Love and Other Myths by Joyce Sutphin, published by Red Dragonfly Press. And the Poetry Award goes to Ray Gonzalez for Beautiful Wall.
Thank you. I've never heard anybody say that the ones that don't get nominated want to be nominated in poetry. I'll have to steal that. Well, thank you. It's quite an honor to receive this award. I've lived in other literary states over the years, over the decades, and I've never seen anything like this in Minnesota. So, first of all, thanks to Minnesota. I want to thank the Friends of the St. Paul Library for their commitment and hard work every year, and thanks to the poetry judges for choosing my book, and also a great hand also to the other finalists. Most of all, I want to thank my wife, Ida, and my granddaughter, Jaden, for their love, patience, and support, and they're here tonight. This is the 40th anniversary of Boa Editions. They've been publishing for four decades, and I've been fortunate to be a part of it for 20 years. I want to acknowledge its founder, the late Al Poulin, for his vision and what he created decades ago when it was just a tiny press in Rochester, New York. And also, I want to thank its current publisher, Peter Connors, and his staff, and they're still in Rochester. Also, most of all, I want to dedicate this award to my late mentor and teacher, Robert Burlingame, who changed my life by opening my eyes to poetry in 1973. Thank you.
Coming up next is the award for Young People's Literature. The category is sponsored by the Creative Writing Programs at Hamline University. It's the only university in the United States with three fine arts programs in creative writing and an award-winning national literary magazine. Hamline offers hands-on, student-centered, active learning in the heart of a dynamic and rich literary community. Let's recognize the Creative Writing Programs at Hamline University. Here to present the award for Young People's Literature, two-time Book Award winner and author of 12 novels for young readers, Will Durbin.
Well, it's an honor to be here tonight and to be a part of this program. When I speak with editors in New York, they're often curious about why we have so many exceptional writers here in Minnesota. Is there something in the water? They've asked more than one occasion. In my opinion, our rich literary tradition is a direct result of the strong investment that we've chosen to make in our schools, our libraries, and our arts communities. As someone who's been privileged to visit more than 1,000 schools and libraries over the past 20 years, I'm happy to report that students today are as thoughtful, creative, and engaged as they ever have been. And as discerning young readers, those same students seek out writers who have a strong voice, writers who are honest and real, writers who are concise in their use of language, but at the same time produce books that mirror the challenges and the complexities of life. Writing such a book is not an easy task, but it's one that the nominees in this category have admirably achieved. The nominees tonight are The Bamboo Sword by Margie Preuss, published by Amulet Abrams, The Firebug of Balrog County by David Oppegard, published by Flux Llewellyn Worldwide, Isabel Day Refuses to Die of a Broken Heart, by Jane St. Anthony, published by the University of Minnesota Press, and See No Color by Shannon Gibney, published by Kale Rota Lab Learner Publishing. And the award tonight goes to Shannon Gibney, See No Color.
As people at table 56 know, I did not write an acceptance speech, which now is seeming inadvisable. It's just been such a wild ride, such a wild 2 years here, and there's so many people to thank. I feel so privileged, I feel so lucky to be a writer here in Minnesota, to have the support that I have from my family, from my friends, from my community. I have to thank my amazing editor, Andrew Carr. I have to thank the amazing staff at Lerner. They have been nothing but professional and just marvelous to work with. I have to thank my husband, Bala Di Corva, and my sister-in-law, Norbo Corva, for watching my kids. And I have to thank my parents, Jim and Sue Gibney, for always believing in me. Most of all, I have to thank the global transracial adoptee community for knowing that our stories are important, connected, and we don't have to exist isolated from each other anymore. I apologize for forgetting somebody important. You don't know what this means to me. Thank you so much. Please, more writers of color, let's get them published and out there, please. Special honor is the biennial award for full-length book of scholarship on the topic of Minnesota history, sponsored by the Hoagnander Family Fund. The inspiration of Orville Joe Hoagnander, this award stems from his family's belief in the importance of studying and preserving history and their long-standing relationship with the Minnesota Historical Society. Please join me in recognizing Joe Hoagnander and his fiancee, Nadia Christensen, for their efforts to pay tribute to scholarly works on Minnesota history. Here to present the award are Gwen Westerman and Bruce White, 2014 honorees for Minnesota Makoche, Land of the Dakota.
Bruce and I are honored to be here today to present the Hoagnander Minnesota History Award to our friend William Green for his book, Degrees of Freedom, The Origin of Civil Rights in Minnesota, 1865 to 1912. From a field of immensely worthy books published in 2014 and 2015, his book was reviewed and chosen by history professor and writer Paula Nelson, who had this to say about his book. Degrees of Freedom is a superb contribution to the study of the early civil rights movement in a northern state and will serve as a model for others to follow. His work is a testament to the power of the many voices that tell Minnesota's stories. Please turn your attention to the screens to learn more about this year's winning book.
Degrees of Freedom continues Bill's vital work in uncovering and sharing in an unprecedented fashion the early history of African-American life and experience in Minnesota and the state's burgeoning civil rights movement. Written with deep scholarly conviction and breadth, but with an eye at all times to making this important history accessible to general readers, Degrees of Freedom covers the half century following the Civil War and lays a foundation for understanding Black life in a northern state, a story too rarely told. Green reveals in persuasive and compelling fashion the little-known historical figures who began this struggle for civil rights in a predominantly white state in the years following the passing of the 15th Amendment. They were farmhands and laborers. They built communities and businesses. They worked as barbers. They started the first black newspapers in Minnesota. And gradually, they laid the groundwork for the advancement of race relations. This is also the story of national champions for racial equality and their work in Minnesota, such as Frederick Douglass, Booker T. Washington, and W.E.B. Du Bois. All at a time when Minnesota had approved black suffrage, yet the lives of black citizens reflected a society that had, in fact, found very little in the way of equality and social freedom.
Degrees of Freedom not only explores this rich history of black Minnesota, but it also grapples with how the idea of Minnesota Nice can be understood in terms of race relations and our state's contribution to the civil rights movement. Green offers us a meaningful look into how Minnesota managed to set precedents in anti-discrimination laws and provide progressive black and white leadership despite having a relatively small black population. He delves into the delicate balance of power between black activists and a progressive white society. Green's book will provide a deeper understanding of the challenges our community has faced and currently faces as we strive to close the achievement gap and move forward in creating a truly equal opportunity for all.
Bill Green has written a thoughtful, probing book about African Americans in Minnesota. It is also, and more fully, about Minnesota, a Minnesota that integrates African Americans into the larger state story. Minnesotans should read this book for lots of reasons. Green writes engagingly, introducing us to the dailiness of the lives of those people he's talking about. He shows us something of the crooked and painful path toward equality. He rejects the simple notion of a straight line upward from the bad old days to a better now. And he demands that we see and feel the complications, frustrations, and setbacks, and why they happened here. His work is not just additive, but should be transformative. We should finish this book with a different understanding of what it has meant and what it means to be a Minnesotan, indeed what it means to be American. Thank you, Bill.
On behalf of the Minnesota Book Awards and the Hoagnander Family Foundation, we present the 2016 Hoagnander Minnesota History Award to William Green for Degrees of Freedom: The Origin of Civil Rights in Minnesota.
Bruce is right. This is heavy. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. For a young man from New Orleans coming to Minnesota some 40 years ago, I had to learn the ways of a new community that, in terms of race relations, comported itself more through nuance and spoke the exotic language of understatement. I came to realize that if I was to gain insight into what would become my adopted home, rather than insist on the world presenting itself in my stark and dualistic terms, I had to learn to appreciate the gray and understand the realm of degrees. I had to learn, in other words, to meet people where they were. I was hooked on their history, which I came to realize included me. I want to thank Bailey and her team for bringing this event about. I want to thank the Friends of the St. Paul Public Library and the Hoagnander family for believing in the value of Minnesota scholarship. I want to thank the University of Minnesota Press and especially Eric Anderson, my editor, for believing in my vision. And most of all, I want to thank my lovely, gracious, and yes, long-suffering wife, Judy, for believing in me. Again, thank you.
Now we have the general nonfiction category, sponsored by the Waterbury Group of Morgan Stanley. For over 40 years, the Waterbury Group of Morgan Stanley has been a family-owned business helping people use finances to create deeper meaning in their lives. Please join me in recognizing the Waterbury Group of Morgan Stanley. The compelling accounts that comprise this category are by four distinguished authors who are all new to the awards. Presenting as last year's Minnesota Book Award winner for Harriet Beecher Stowe, A Spiritual Life, Nancy Kester.
I'm honored and delighted to be here tonight. And one of the most beautiful things about writing in the field called general nonfiction is the nearly unlimited freedom to find a subject that speaks to you. The four books under consideration tonight range very widely in style and tone and topic, and they add greatly to our collection of new nonfiction work by Minnesotans. These books show an impressive depth of knowledge in everything from a detailed study of architecture to important social concerns, such as a thoughtful discourse on rape culture and an immersion into the world of homeless LGBTQ teens in New York, as well as a provocative exposé of the dieting industry. Books like these open our eyes to our world in ways that we may not have considered before, and we are the better for reading. So the finalists are Asking for It, The Alarming Rise of Rape Culture and What We Can Do About It, by Kate Harding, published by DeCapo Press, Perseus Books Group, and John H. Howe, Architect, from Taliesin Apprentice to Master of Organic Design by Jane King Hessian and Tim Quigley, published by University of Minnesota Press. And No House to Call My Home, Love, Family, and Other Transgressions by Ryan Berg, published by Nation Books, Perseus Book Group. And finally, Secrets from the Eating Lab, The Science of Weight Loss, The Myth of Willpower, and Why You Should Never Diet Again, by Tracy Mann, published by Harper Wave, HarperCollins Publishers. And the award goes to Ryan Berg, No House to Call My Home, Ryan Berg.
Wow, wasn't expecting that. Thank you so much let me start over. thank you so much to the Minnesota Book Awards and the other finalists who are all amazing writers, and you should go out and buy their books right now. I want to thank some people locally who have really supported and championed the book. Gary from Majors & Quinn, who is here tonight, thank you so much for all you've done to get word out about the book and to support the book and set up an amazing event. Lavender Magazine was very supportive of the book. Sharon Jackson from Star Tribune, Aaron Dahl from Hennepin County Library, Public Library, was fantastic and put together an event. The very first person who ever read my words is in the audience tonight, my cousin Jess. So thank you for making me a better writer. My parents are with me tonight as well. This book would not exist without your unconditional love and support. And I'd like to thank Nation Books, who believed in this book and put everything behind it. They were courageous in taking the subject on. It's a subject that many people don't want to discuss. And lastly, I'd like to thank the youth that I worked with and the youth I continue to work with who experience homelessness on every night. They have taught me the meaning of love, of resilience, of tenacity, and of hope. So this award tonight is dedicated to them. Thank you.
Memoir and creative nonfiction, sponsored by Greta and Kevin Warren, who are book lovers who encourage everyone to keep reading and keep learning. Let's give them a round of applause. The personal experiences of this year's writers represent journeys of all kinds, to understanding between a daughter and the memories of her father, to a poignant exploration of dying, to tracing the way water has imprinted on our consciousness, to a discovery of place through food ecology. Here tonight, as the presenter, is Kata Schwain, last year's winner for Tailings, a Memoir.
Hello. Our newspapers and Twitter feeds and Facebook timelines are filled with news of a world that is broken. Simone Weil said, "Looking is what saves us." In a world as broken as ours, I am so grateful for creative nonfiction writers like the ones nominated tonight, who direct their gazes towards interior and exterior landscapes and refuse to look away. They turn unflinchingly towards water and earth, toward food and war and family and friendship and dying. And in so doing, the books nominated tonight offer us a rare thing in this broken world: hope. Here are this year's finalists. In Winter's Kitchen by Beth Dooley, published by Milkweed Editions. The War Came Home with Him, A Daughter's Memoir by Catherine Madison, published by University of Minnesota Press. Water and What We Know, Following the Roots of a Northern Life by Karen Babine, published by University of Minnesota Press. And We Know How This Ends, Living While Dying by Bruce Kramer with Kathy Werzer, published by University of Minnesota Press. And the award goes to Karen Babine, Water and What We Know, Following the Roots of a Northern Life.
Thank you. Thank you so much to the Minnesota Book Awards and to the Friends of the St. Paul Public Library. It is amazing to be here. It is amazing to be here among such amazing finalists. I am truly humbled to be in this crowd. When I was a sophomore in college, I took a Minnesota writers class, and it really was for me the turning point in becoming a writer. I understood that I could write about Minnesota, I could write about my hometown, I could write about my rural hometown, and people would care, and people would understand what I was trying to do. when we lose the belief that our places are important, when we start believing that important things happen elsewhere, we put our landscape and our own futures in danger. Writing of place can be the antidote. So thank you so much, the University of Minnesota Press and Eric Anderson. I couldn't have done this without you. And to my family, without whom there would be no book at all. So thank you.
To honor a Minnesota book artist for excellence in contributions to Minnesota book arts community with a Book Artist Award supported by Lerner Publishing Group and presented with the Minnesota Center for Book Arts. Early in its history, MCBA was housed at Lerner Publishing, and the sponsorship of the Book Artist Award continues a long tradition and interest in book arts on the part of Lerner Publishing. Thanks to Lerner Publishing. Here to make tonight's presentation is Regula Russell, winner of the Book Artist Award in 2011.
Hello. For two decades, Wendy has been making spirit-filled and thought-inviting artist books. She has also made a huge contribution to the well-being, pizzazz, and spunk of Minnesota's book arts community. Wendy is big-hearted, super talented, and super kind. If during the next week, or the next month, or the next year, you would like to hold and page through and maybe purchase one of Wendy's amazing books, the shop at the Minnesota Center for Book Arts is the place to go. You will be surprised how affordable her smaller books are. They are priced well under $100. Please join me in watching the screens right now for the tribute to Wendy.
I've been a practitioner of Buddhism, yoga, and Christianity for over a decade. For me, they are a trinity that join together at the sense of being one. One with the divine, one with each other, one with the world around us.
Wendy Fernstrom has been making artist books since the mid-1990s. She's a deep thinker, and in turn, she makes us think as well. Are we able to let go of our individual concerns for the sake of the whole? What is the residue of broken promises? Are we awake to the mornings in our lives? And with this, her newest work, One is the Holiest Number, Wendy asks, what is the nature of oneness? What does it mean to be whole? And how do we integrate tears in the fabric of our existence?
What I enjoy about Wendy's work is her ability to communicate complex and conceptual content in a manner that is accessible. Whether her subject matter is the work of the 13th century Persian poet Rumi or personal reflections on loss and relationships, her books are engaging and communicate universal messages. She works smart and pushes the traditional definitions of book. She chooses a format that most effectively communicates her message. One is the Holiest Number, number two, is a multi-signature codex incorporating relief, intaglio, and letterpress printing. Text is minimal, allowing a variety of shapes, patterns, and textures to communicate content. Innovative page designs that hide and reveal imagery prompt readers to slow their pace and provide opportunities for personal reflection. Quiet and unassuming, this artist book is a wonderful combination of material form and narrative content.
Wendy and I met 2 decades ago in a letterpress class at Minnesota Center for Book Arts. Her abundant abilities and generosity of spirit were clearly evident as she mixed colors, set type, and help the rest of us in our small class move along. Wendy soared. It earned her the nickname Fearless Fern. Wendy is one of those people who share her knowledge quietly and generously. I believe Wendy brings an attitude of artistic abundance everywhere she goes. Be this as member of Minnesota Center for Book Arts artist community or elsewhere in the wider community. Her impressive body of work, conceived, written, and made by Wendy herself, is inspirational. Wendy is wonderful. On behalf of the very generous Lerner Publishing Group, the Minnesota Book Awards, and Minnesota Center for Book Arts, I present the 2016 Book Artist Award to the exceptional Wendy Fernstrom. Here she goes.
It's pretty amazing. Time flies when you're making books. Regula and I have blossomed as book artists together. Thank you, Regula, for introducing me and for all of the gifts you shared over the years. Thank you, Lerner Publishing Group and Minnesota Center for Book Arts, for honoring me with this year's Book Artist Award. And thank you, friends of the St. Paul Public Library, for all that you do to make these book awards and this fabulous night so wonderful. As you heard from the video, the title of my artist book is One is the Holiest Number. I bet you thought one was the loneliest number. Well, it can feel that way, just like Three Dog Night said in their song from 1968. And lonely is definitely the way I felt in early 2013, when yet another relationship with a significant other had ended. But after a few months of being on my own, I had an epiphany. What if my beloved weren't just one special person? What if my friends were my beloved? What if everyone were my beloved? What would it be like to open my heart to all of those beloveds? And so I began the shift from what I had learned about yoga and Buddhism and Christianity into practice. I was happier and more at peace when I felt at one with the universe, recognizing that we are not alone, but rather all one. I feel the need to thank not just wonderful people like Regula and Jeff Rathermel and Patrick Coleman and Michael Hall for helping me to thrive as an artist and as a human being. I want to thank everyone from my past, everyone who is in my life right now, and I thank all of you, even if I haven't met you yet. We are all one. Our actions and our words ripple into infinity, influencing each other in ways known and unknown. Mahatma Gandhi said, "Be the change you wish to see in the world." I say, be the love you wish to see in the world.
In 2012, the Library of Congress designated the Friends as the Minnesota Center for the Book. And that designation has made all the difference to writers and readers throughout the state. In addition to this celebration that we're enjoying tonight, our work as the Center for the Book enables us to support the work of writers in the schools, to celebrate our literary heritage through programs like the Minnesota Writers Map, and to inspire school-age youth through Letters About Literature, a national letter writing contest. Now, I understand we have some winners of the Letters for Literature contest in attendance tonight. Is that right? Anyone here? We would like those winners to stand up as Greg and I read your names. Alexander Jadu. Marie Schumacher. Ani Heikala.
Grace Ritzenthaler. Natalie Anderson. Ariane Giulatti. Danny Dalside.
Julie Eilers. And Claire Hanks. Congratulations to all of you. Let's give them all a round of applause.
So, our next category is Minnesota. The four writers and books that comprise the finalists for this award help us plumb the depths of our state history, shared culture, and natural world. The Minnesota category is sponsored by St. Mary's University of Minnesota. Here to present the award is last year's book award winner for Her Honor, Rosalie Wall, and the Minnesota Women's Movement, Lori Sturdivant.
Thank you, Stephanie. When people know their state's story, they care about it more. And when they care about it more, they become better citizens. They participate more vigorously, they vote more carefully, and they govern this state more wisely. We have so much to be proud of in this state, and so many fine authors tonight in our midst to expand our appreciation of this land where the prairies and forests meet, of the water that is our signature resource, of the people who came first and then next and are still coming, and of all the wonders those people created for the betterment of their own lives and for the enrichment of ours. Here are tonight's finalists in the Minnesota category. Minnesota Modern, Architecture, and Life at Mid-Century by Larry Millette. Photography by Dennis Shari and Maria Foray Sari, published by University of Minnesota Press. Minnesota State of Wonders by Brian Peterson. Stories by Carrie Westenberg, published by Mark Hirsch Publishing. North Shore, A Natural History of Minnesota's Superior Coast by Chell Anderson and Adelheid Fisher, published by University of Minnesota Press. And Warrior Nation, A History of the Red Lake Ojibwe by Anton Troyer, published by Minnesota Historical Society Press. And the award And the award goes to Larry Millette, Minnesota Modern.
Thank you very much. I just wanted to start by introducing Maria and Dennis Sari, who took the wonderful photographs for this book. And it was a real pleasure to work with them on this book. And boy, their contribution to it was amazing. When I was a lad back in a previous century, my mother used to tell me, brevity is the soul of wit. And so I'm going to keep this brief. I want to thank a few people, obviously Dennis and Maria. I also want to thank Eric Anderson at the U of M Press, and also Christian Veeton at the U of M Press, who was my photo wrangler and did a fabulous job collecting photos from all over the country to use in this book. I want to thank my old friend Gar Hargens. Gar and I was researching this book for about, 6-7 years, and we would go on scenic bike tours of Richfield. I believe we are the only people who have ever gone on scenic bike tours of Richfield. And finally, I want to thank my wife, Jody Ahern, who has actually done the artwork for a number of my books, who is my official prose wrangler, and keeps my wayward prose in check as my copy editor and also the love of my life. Thank you all very much.
Category award of the evening, we have genre fiction. This category is sponsored by McAllister College. Please join me now in welcoming last year's book award winner, the author of The Secret of Pembroke Park, Julie Clausen.
Thank you. Tonight's genre fiction finalists, they represent a great range. We have a debut book in the gangster noir style, St. Paul style. We have established an award-winning mystery and thriller series and some out-of-this-world science fiction. The four books featured tonight provide chilling and thrilling adventures for all of us. The finalists are The Devereaux Decision by Steve McElstrom, published by Calumet Editions. The Grave Soul by Ellen Hart, published by Minotaur Books. He's Either Dead or in St. Paul, I love that title, by D.B. Moon, published by Three Waters Publishing. And Season of Fear by Brian Freeman, published by Quercus. And the award for genre fiction goes to Ellen Hart, The Grave Soul. Ellen's not able to be here this evening, so accepting on her behalf is Carl Brookins.
Oh, hot dog. I'm not Ellen Hart, but she's a dear friend of mine. I hope I don't break down and explain this to you. She's due to some health problems, is unable to be with us tonight, except in spirit. She is not with us tonight, but I'm sure she is really excited and happy for this award. Look around you. We are an incredible literary community. She and I are only one, and I want to say to you on her behalf, thank you ever so much for this fine and wonderful award, and we'll see you next year with more books. Thank you.
Now it's my pleasure to introduce our third special award, the Kay Sexton Award, sponsored by St. Catherine University's Master of Information and Library Science. It is an honor bestowed on an individual or organization for outstanding contribution to Minnesota's literary community. The award is named for Kay Sexton, a career bookseller and dedicated arts advocate. Here tonight to introduce the honoree with a special tribute video are Gail C., former owner of the Bookcase of Wyzetta, and David Unowski, founder of the Hungry Mind Bookstore, both previous Kay Sexton honorees.
Hey, We couldn't be more pleased to join in this tribute to Jim Sitter. Please turn your attention to the screen for a brief look at his exceptional literary life. Jim Sitter came to the Twin Cities in the mid-70s, a brilliant, somewhat green young man from the wilds of North Dakota, complete with cowboy hat and string belt. His work has greatly enhanced and improved the literary landscape in town, as well as the funding climate. At Hungry Mind, he started a reading series, which went on to host 100 Pulitzer winners and 5 Nobelists, and laid the groundwork for what is the great reading climate in the Twin Cities today. There's nobody that I can think of more deserving than Jim for this Kay Sexton Award. Thanks a lot, Hungry Jim.
Jim Sitter's early endeavors involved his friendship with former Minnesota Governor Elmer Anderson, who encouraged and supported him with Bookslinger, an innovative small press distributor. Jim's association with the governor led directly to the foundation of Minnesota Center for Book Arts and its remarkable inaugural board that Jim put together to carry out his creative ideas for the organization. Kay Sexton was part of that original board, as were Elmer Anderson, Mickey Friedman, James Alcott, and many other local literary luminaries.
Jim Sitter envisioned the ideal center for the art of the book and brought that vision to life one conversation at a time. Hundreds of conversations later, Minnesota Center for Book Arts opened in 1985 in the Minneapolis Warehouse District. Artists worked in printing, papermaking, and binding studios. A nascent shop sold artists' books, and a gallery displayed work by Minnesotans alongside that of national and international artists. Adult learners expanded MCBA's lively artists' community in its classes, and school tours visited its studios. Today, the children of those children visit MCBA. Inclusive, welcoming, community-based, these Minnesotan values lie at the heart of Jim Sitter's vision. That vision has continued to be fueled by the creativity, persistence, and hard work of many throughout MCBA's 30-year lifespan and its leadership today, as it enriches the lives of thousands of Minnesotans through the art of the book.
Jim Sitter was arguably the first person in the country to think about the organizations, the publishers, the literary centers as forming a field. I think you can see people who have had a vision for a particular organization, but Jim Sitter had a vision for all of us. He looked at other fields like theater and visual art, and he saw that they had a presence, they had a critical mass. And he and some foundations here in the Twin Cities and the Minnesota, I think, were feeling we need to have literature represented. We need to support literature. If we're supporting these other art forms, why not literature too? And so he spoke to Scott Walker, the founder of Grey Wolf, encouraged him to move to the Twin Cities. He encouraged Alan Kornblum to move to the Twin Cities. And, you know, we're still here 30-odd years later in the case of Grey Wolf, and we have him to thank for that. There was a real generosity of spirit behind what he did. And I don't think there's really anybody before or since who's had more vision on behalf of everybody than Jim Sitter.
I just want to add and end with some words from Gigi Bradford, who was a former literature program director at the NEA, the National Endowment for the Arts. And Gigi says, Jim Sitter has made an indelible mark, not just on the literary landscape of Minnesota, but on the nation. It was Jim's vision and his perseverance that spearheaded private philanthropic initiatives bringing over $9 million to strengthen literary organizations across the country. It was Jim who figured out how to save literary fellowships at the National Endowment for the Arts. To this day, they remain the only grants for individuals allowed at the agency. No one else has influenced so many sectors of the literary world, and no one else has been so modest in these accomplishments.
The Kay Sexton Award is richly deserved, and the national literary landscape is shaped by his vision, energy, and his continued seat at the table. And I just want to add, it's a wonderful, wonderful moment, Jim Sitter. We all thank you.
All of us here, writers, readers, publishers, and booksellers, owe a great debt of gratitude to Jim. On behalf of St. Catharines University, the Minnesota Book Awards, and the entire Minnesota book community, it's my pleasure and honor to present the Kay Sexton Award to Jim Sitter.
Thank you to the friends, thank you to the sponsors, thank you to the donors, and to borrow from Allen Ginsberg, whatever you're doing, I'm for it. And to borrow from Mr. Anderson and David Unowski and John Taylor, JT, and a little bit also borrowing from me, the thing you're thinking about doing next, I'm probably even more for that. And to borrow completely from me, the thing you're thinking about doing long term, I've been very lucky. I really am for you doing that, all of you. Kay is not here. Alan Kornblum's not here. Mr. Anderson's not here. If I thanked everyone I need to thank, Betty Bright could tell you we'd be here 3 hours. So we're not going to do that. You know who you are.
All right. Are you ready? Aw. Time for our final award of the evening. It's novel and short story, sponsored by Education Minnesota, the state's educators union, representing 70,000 professionals working together for excellence in education for all students. Please join me in recognizing Education Minnesota and their governing board. Our four finalists range from those new to the category to returning finalists and veteran award winners with a vast fiction array of styles and stories. Joining us to present the award is two-time Minnesota Book Award winner and Man Booker Award recipient, Marlon James.
Good night. So I've decided to tear myself away from my day job, which is starting fights on Facebook, to present this award. I have to confess that Richard is right. I have a serious case of poet envy. I might as well get that one out. But you know, there are things that I think, I'm a big believer in a novel, because there are things that a novel can do that I don't think any other art form can do. There are things about the South that Huckleberry Finn can teach us that Shelby Foote just can't, which is not a knock on Shelby Foote, who's a phenomenal writer and a great man. A novel, unlike nonfiction, a novel is a pack of lies. It's a pack of lies that we trust, we depend on to tell these greater truths. It's the type of history book that tells internal history. It's the type of work where we sometimes explore nuance and get lost, and that's all art. But there's something about the flipping of a page. You know, nobody's more happy than I am that the ebook has crested and has gone as far as it can go. Because there is something just about the flipping the pages of a book. There's something of a book that still follows that sort of Charles Dickens motto of make them laugh, make them cry, make them wait. I think in the recent years we've added make them squirm, make them write a think piece about it next day, and all sort of other things. You know, the novels that are nominated tonight, they cover such a range. They cover private landscapes, they cover personal landscapes. They're achingly intimate, they're wildly fantastical, sometimes in the very same category, in the very same book. So the nominees, this year's finalists for novel and short story are The Deadlands by Benjamin Percy, published by Grand Central Publishing and Hachette Book Group. The Patron Saint of Lost Comfort Lake by Rachel Coyne, published by New Rivers Press. Prudence by David Troyer, published by Riverhead Books, Penguin. And There's Something I Want You to Do by Charles Baxter, published by Pantheon Books, Random House. And the award goes to... I'm so glad I'm on this side of the envelope this year. It goes to Charles Baxter for There's Something I Want You to Do.
There's a sign here that says, speak loud and clearly. I'll try. What a time to be at a loss for words. I want to thank the friends of the St. Paul Public Library. I want to thank my editor, Dan Frank, and everyone at Pantheon Random House. I want to thank my family, particularly my son, Daniel, who reads through my manuscripts and always straightens the chronologies out. I want to take my hat off, the one that I'm not wearing, to the other finalists, my friends. And I want to say something also about mentoring. My first creative writing teacher, Alvin Greenberg, who taught at McAllister College, died this past year, and he taught me how to love literature, how to mentor, how to love the North Shore. And every writer who is in this room who has ever been encouraged or mentored knows how much that can mean in getting a start. So, thank you all.
Friends has relied on a strong partnership with libraries around the state, especially the St. Paul Public Library in its 10 years running the Book Awards. And here to close the evening is the director. Please welcome Jane Eastwood.
Good evening. Thank you. This really is a privilege to be able to close the evening by doing a joyful thing, which is thanking all of the organizations and individuals who made this evening possible, especially our statewide library partners, the Council of Regional Public Library System Administrators, and the Metropolitan Library Service Agency, as well as our other partners, the Loft Literary Center and St. Paul Almanac, and our media partners, Minnesota Public Radio, the Star Tribune, St. Paul Neighborhood Network, and Twin Cities Public Television. Let me also say thank you to the Minnesota Book Awards director, the amazing Elaine Hopkins, coordinator. She deserves your applause. Coordinator Bailey Wiesenmeyer, and event. And events director Liz Boyd. And to the judges, panelists, and other volunteers, the staffs of the St. Paul Public Library, and the wonderful friends of the St. Paul Public Library, and to all our financial supporters. Of course, we do need to give a hand to our band, the Willie August Project. We have Ben Seams on guitar, Jeremy Hauer on drums, Amanda Bergdorf on cello, Jim Chenoweth on upright bass. And finally, a big round of applause for our MC tonight, Stephanie Curtis.
And thanks to all of you for being part of the 28th Annual Minnesota Book Awards. We hope to see you back next year in April for the 29th Annual Awards Ceremony, now that your reading appetite has been whetted by all these great books. So remember that Richfield has good biking tours. What else are we worried? Wendy Fernstrom's books are surprisingly affordable at MCBA. Cousin Jess is a great first reader. And dedicate a book to your wife, and you may win an award. There you go. Please join us for the epilogue celebration in the reception area, sponsored by Overdrive. There'll be champagne for toasting the authors, desserts, book sales, and a live performance by the Southside Aces. Good night, good reading. Thank you for being here.